What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the channel. I'm Steven. This is Steven in Stereo. And in today's video, we're going to be diving into part two of Blood on the Drums from Ashton Irwin's. I loved disc one. I actually didn't even know that there was going to be another piece to this. So this was not only a surprise, but I was actually shocked to start getting all these comments about, like, when are you doing the other half of the album? Didn't even know that was going to be a thing. So I'm really excited about diving even further into this because I feel like Ashton Irwin's musical journey has been really awesome to hear, especially just him putting out his first project. And of course, everything he's done with 5 Seconds of Summer has really been incredible. The evolution of that band alone, so sick. So I'm excited to dive into this. Before we do, don't forget to check out Patreon, where I have part one of this as a full uncut album listening party. I will have this video. And of course, if you are a fan of Super Bloom, I have that as an album listening party. And of course, 5 Seconds of Summer, I have so much content for that band over there. So if you're a fan of any of those things, it is super cheap to support me over there. Links in the description. But I'm super excited to dive into this. The first track that we're checking out today on disc two is The Canyon. So let's do it. Woof. Got that like rough kind of like rock sound. Oh. Giving me some Sting and the Police right there. Sick riff. Wait, okay. One of the things I love just about having like a drummer's perspective on like a full project is sick, because listen to these drum fills right here. Right here. Simple, but sick. Oh! I'm sorry, but that bass right there, that doom, 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 and then he comes in with that rasp, I'm into it so much. Oh, yeah. It's so cool that he's making, like, he is kind of owning this sound that, again, I'm kind of like getting the Sting and the Police kind of vibe. And, you know, because I know that Ashton Irwin has such a broad taste of music, it is really interesting to get to hear his solo works. I feel like he just tries out so many things. And again, it's so cool to hear that drummer's perspective on like a full band. Sick. I wonder if Ashton played everything on this one too. It just got 70s all over it. That, whatever that lead instrument is right there, it might just be a synth. That is so sick. I feel like synthesizer design, like when you get into like the sound design of it, man, you can do so much, and it's just so fucking cool to see the versatility of the synthesizer. I'm so thankful for the invention of that. I love the song so much because I feel like Ashton really gives us just so much in one track. I feel like I heard so many musical styles here, and it really felt like a journey. And I feel like that's really important because, at least for me, when I was picking up on the meaning of the song, and remember, guys, just in case you're new here, I'm probably wrong every time. Just my perspective. Just saying. All right. So this song, to me, feels like The Canyon is a representation of life, and sort of like the canyon is us kind of looking at life. And it's this, you know, it's, you're like in ground and you got like peaks and valleys and all these things and mountains and all this stuff. And it's a big canyon, but it is life. And I think from that, there's a couple things that kind of happened in the song. But the thing that really stuck out to me was when he was kind of like almost like coming to terms with the fact that at some point his life will end. And I feel like this is like a thing that like we all are going to go through. So at some point, you do have to come like face to face with the fact that you will not be here forever. It's like the time you're here has to matter, right? Or at least you want to make it matter. And I feel like, especially with the emotional kind of feeling in the vocals I was hearing, I felt like, you know, there's a lot of vulnerability here, but there's also a lot of pain, but there's kind of like a hopefulness to things here, especially again with that like lead synthesizer and stuff. But all those things just kind of, to me, feel like it represents like the beauty of life, but also the kind of like, yeah, it's beautiful and it's this big, wonderful, most amazing thing, but like, don't take it for granted. That's kind of what I got out of the song. It's one of those songs you definitely have to listen to again because there's so many pieces to this. And for me, hearing Ashton's vocals over this track, truly one of my favorite things. I really do feel like he has such a good grasp on this rock kind of sound. And again, not only do I love it for his own stuff, but remember, with everything that these dudes do in their own music, all of that at some point trickles back into 5 Seconds of Summer. So for me, I love to hear Ashton Irwin doing his own thing, and I love to hear how great this is. And I also love the benefit, call me selfish, but the benefit of just seeing one of my favorite bands continue to get better. All right, this next track is California Holds Her Breath.
She couldn't stay, they don't command her. She wanted answers, she wanted answers. I wanna know,
ooh,
where you go to show your secret.
The vocal mixing is so good right here. Just having his vocal hit and then some of the harmonies hit louder in different ears. Separation is so sick.
I'd reflected off that, ooh, disco ball, writing down your next confession on the bathroom wall.
Oh.
While you're hiding underneath your makeup, I still see you cry.
Wait, this is so beautiful because, again, moments like this where I get that stripped back kind of thing, I get to hear Ashton's vocals kind of like isolated for a second. Love stripped back instrumentals like this. He's got a lot of vocal talent, especially for this style.
Fashion on the bathroom wall. While you're hiding underneath your makeup, I still see you cry. Mirror, why?
Oh.
Tell me why is it so? When you're dancing toe-to-toe with things
you... Wait, his voice harmonized is like, I'm fucking getting so giddy right now. That whole section.
Is it so? When you're dancing toe-to-toe with things you fear, it's blurry and ugly.
Yes. That song right there just did something so beautiful because it spent the entire time building up to create a very sort of cinematic, atmospheric, and monumental moment. I feel like by the end of this song, I was driving on the coast of California because I finally made it to a place where I could be accepted for who I am and follow the dreams I want, which is exactly, in my opinion, unless there's a bigger metaphor here, which there definitely could be. But for me, it seems like a girl from Indiana who has these dreams and these big hopes, but she feels so stuck and lost where she lives and she's sad. She cries, you know, the tears on her face. Oh my gosh, that could have been tears all over the place. But I feel like with all of those things that we're getting, once she, you know, Ashton's trying to say like, there's this place that kind of like lets you follow your dreams and lets you kind of like, you know, do whatever it is that you want to do. So anytime you feel like you're alone or feel like you're lost, your dreams don't matter, you find that bar on the side of the highway to write your dreams on. I could be wrong about that, but I really do feel like that's kind of what we're getting here. And I think that's really cool too, because, you know, obviously remember like Ashton, you know, from Australia, right? But I think it's, you know, he lives in LA right now. He probably lives both places. He's pretty successful. But what I love is that like, even someone who like wasn't born and grown up all around California and stuff, obviously if you live in America, like you know, like the influence that California has and all that stuff. But the fact that you come from other countries and, you know, even just living there, one, they, you know, all of Five Seconds of Summer moved to LA at some point, right, to continue their success. But it's cool that somebody who has not just lived here their entire life also kind of understands the draw that it has. But like, keep in mind, there's two sides to that, because like, California absolutely has the draw, but like, it's not always a good thing. Sometimes people go there and they'll do everything trying to follow their dream, and it's just hard. It's a place where I feel like a lot of dreams can die as well, but it is also the place where if you're going to follow your dreams, it's like that or New York, baby. All right, this next one is Little Spark. Oh shit. It's all I need to readjust my mood. Roxy, Thompson, keeps me going. Sarah, toning, keep it flowing. What would my life be like? Then heard your voice, not even like I had a choice. Somebody else. I know it's something so small, but I'm a huge fan of being able to actually hear the fingers sliding on that acoustic guitar as it changes notes. I think that it personally sounds so fucking cool, and I love the raw kind of feel of it. Fucking go. Okay, I love songwriting like this. Like I said, come on, first time listen, when you can pick up the chorus, or like even just like part of the hook by the end of it, it's only 2.5 minutes long. That's really solid songwriting, in my opinion. I am a big fan of this track because I like the idea of likening, you know, this metaphor for somebody being that one spark in your life, that thing that lights up everything. Because sometimes when you're so low and you just need that oxytocin, you just need that serotonin, you need anything to give you a flicker of hope into life. Sometimes in the darkest moments, all it takes is a spark, because that spark can ignite something within us. Being in love can be a great spark, but it definitely feels to me like Ashton is, I don't know, part of it makes it seem like he's missing his little spark. Like, I feel like he's speaking from the perspective of, I've lost my little spark. Like, what will my life be like now without my spark? Because he said he's like hearing people like having sex next door. He's listening to the sounds of the city and all this stuff. So it makes me think that he's alone at that moment, and that darkness could possibly be there because his little spark is not there. But that kind of songwriting is sick. I love the end of this song so much, because I felt like, I was going to say, like, the only thing that I want is I wish that the instrumental would come in a little bit harder into the chorus. And I had that criticism sitting in my head, but then the bridge came and actually brought those guitars to life a bit more, and I actually really appreciated that. So it worked out perfectly. So that was sick. All right, this next track is Wicked Habit. The moments of the daylight, I let slip away. Okay, there we go. All that like pop punk glory. Come on, that is pop punk 101 right there. What do you say? Hold on. I just want that whole fucking delivery right there is pop punk for perfection, which, by the way, I feel like he has way more than enough credibility in the pop punk space to be able to do this, because 5 Seconds of Summer started out straight up pop punk. I feel like it is just so like pop punk of Ashton to liken his relationship to having a wicked habit, to having this thing that you can't stop. You can't get enough of it. Remember, habits can be both good and bad. Even a good habit can be bad at some point. So I like there's kind of that perspective too. But it's a wicked habit, Ashton, and I love that the pop punk idness of you has come out. This is such a good pre-chorus. Let's drop that, baby. Such a wicked like Warped Tour. Come on. That vocal part right there, that bit of you moment, so good. Oh! Fucking go off. Holy shit. You know what? I need Ashton to give himself more moments like that, even if it's just 8 seconds, even if it's just like a one bar or like a four bar moment, just that moment for him to just break off beat and get, not even break off beat, but just break off and then get to do his own little solo for a minute. Those fills are fucking awesome. And again, I obviously know that Ashton is so much more than a drummer, but it is also really cool just because I know he's such a great drummer. And also remember the songwriting part here is really cool from a drummer's perspective. I talk about that a lot, but it's cool to me. I don't know, like, it's just not the instrument that I think is writing the songs a lot of the time, if you know what I'm saying. Like, oftentimes if someone's sitting there with a guitar, I imagine that, yeah, they're gonna write this melody, this chord progression, and then they can sing the song, and that makes sense. But when the drummer is writing it, it's really cool to me because they hear the song in almost a different way. It's like sometimes you start with the drums when you're making a song, you know? So I think that's really cool. I love the pop punk feel of this so much. The energy is high, which I think is exactly why I love pop punk. The energy is high, but I love the lyrical value of pop punk, and I love the lyrical value of the song. The idea of just having somebody that is a wicked habit, it's either good or bad for you, but it doesn't matter. You're going to pursue it either way. You know, and maybe it's just your love. It's a wicked habit. You just gotta have it. All right, this is Marry You. I've been up and down. I've been down and out. Baby, hear me out. I've got my head in the clouds. It's got a picture of the both of us. I picture Ashton in this and like wearing a suit, and it's like super dark, but he's like, you know, walking out in the city life. Fucking love a track where you know that Ashton is just feeling himself in this. Baby, right before we met, feels like the living dead. Dude, I'm sorry. I love Ashton and his like confident era. Dude, Ashton and those higher vocals. Fuck. I feel like I should be like doing like a salsa type thing to this. There's so much too if you just listen to the instrumental as much as you can. I know there's like a lot going on in like the best way. You can hear like these whistles, you can hear these there's so much like random percussion and things that are kind of going on. And I love how those things that if you listen to on their own, it may seem chaotic, but when you hear it together in context, it sounds so fucking cool. The shaker, but it sounds like a rattlesnake. It's just giving me like, just I said, it's black suit Ashton Irwin. I feel like he is, you know, got the hair slicked back and he is going to be very confident and put the moves down. And I love what he's saying here is like, you know, I can't even control the things I'm saying. I want to marry you. The idea of just being like, I can't stop myself from just like spitting out all these things my heart wants because I'm so like drawn to you. And that kind of brings that like dark, mysterious kind of feel of the song to life even more, because I do feel like they're, you know, like, in a night out and he meets this person and he's just so like infatuated with that person, or he's just so kind of like drawn to them and he just wants to, you know what, like, we have to be together, I'm gonna marry you, I'm gonna do whatever I can. And there's this confidence about him where he's like, I'm just gonna say whatever because I just feel like I have to in order to be able to try to, I don't know, capture this moment forever. So love that so much. I love him singing in that little bit higher of a range, almost falsetto, but not quite, just that higher voice. so fucking sick, especially as it goes up even higher. I think in that like chorus right there, it's just that little bit higher. Then you get the whistles going. And again, I got to give it up to the amount of, you know, shakes and rattlesnake sounds and whistles and bells and who knows whatever else is going on in there, because it all came together so beautifully. Okay, Ashton, do that again and I'm gonna marry you. All right, this is Glory Days.
Do you remember?
I'm sorry, I hate to be annoying by interrupting every single song ever, but this has to be one of my favorite vocal moments from Ashton Irwin ever. I think this is a really strong presentation of what he has to offer right here. Like, I almost hear like a little bit of like Patrick Stump in his voice a little bit, like some Fall Out Boy. There's like a couple others that I'm hearing, but that stands out to me. I think there's like the soulfulness that Patrick has in his voice, and Ashton like can channel a little bit of that in his own. And I think that's incredible. Especially that higher, like almost like nasal sound.
Sounding like a perfect story of the glory.
Oh, fuck, dude. This might be my favorite Ashton Irwin song ever.
Sounding like a perfect story.
Okay, that was sick how that came back in. Listen to this, because it sounds like the guitar like crawls into this. One more time. You can even tell in the mix that it like the loudness goes up right there. That is definitely my favorite song I've heard from Ashton Irwin ever. Are you kidding me? Like, there's no way that that song doesn't blow up as a commercial success. I feel like everything about that is something that sounds perfect to me. And I mean that in the actual sense. Like, every single thing is perfectly executed in the song. I love the main riff of the song. Just that easy, simple, palm muted guitar riff reminds me a lot of like Boys of Summer. That kind of sound is such a nostalgic sound, but at the same time, it's timeless. I feel like you can put this type of sound out anytime and people are going to have that same warm feeling that it gives. I also feel like this is by far my favorite vocal performance from Ashton ever. I feel like this really shows the not only the talent that he has, but just what he has put in to get there, because the execution of these vocals were incredible. And again, he truly has these moments where I hear this Patrick Stump coming out of him, and I just feel like that is one of the like most amazing vocalists of my time, like of our time, but like especially like growing up, like listening to a lot of like emo, and then like, you know, more of the like pop punk emo and alternative emo and alternative rock that kind of like took over the early 2000s. Dude, I feel like Ashton fucking nails that. So love that so much. The meaning of the song to me kind of has a couple things. At first, Glory Days, I was listening to it before we got further into the song. I was immediately thinking back to 5 Seconds of Summer and just kind of like the start of those things. You know, sometimes the Glory Days, you know, especially when he's speaking about, you know, the adrenaline of it all, not knowing what was going to happen, but just diving all in. I feel like that can easily be, you know, talked about in the perspective of the band, because remember, they were very young and they dove all the way in, and they moved and they did all these things to follow the dream of being in this band. And while those dreams obviously came true and then some, there is still kind of that feel of like jumping into the van for the first time and like not knowing what you're going to do, and kind of like the thrill of all of that as well. But I think that as things kind of went on, it is that similar kind of feeling, but I feel like it could be more about a friendship or a relationship. It definitely feels like it's going to be more of a relationship than this, because it seems to me, like he says, like, I wish we would have stayed in touch. I wish we'd done all these things, but we were living those glory days. You know, you end up in a relationship or you end up close with somebody who it's not for a long time, but it's a good time and you're going to have a great time. You're going to, you know, make all these memories with them. And, you know, it probably doesn't work out. It never does, actually. And it was never really supposed to. But it's a thing that kind of teaches you so much about life. It's some, you know, you date somebody who's like a little bit more like free than you are or something. And then you go on these like journeys, you see more things and you just, I don't know. I just think we dive all the way in sometimes into these relationships when we're younger, because we kind of like don't go in with hesitations. We go in kind of like diving all the way in, not knowing what's going to happen, but embracing whatever happens. And kind of feel like that's what he was saying here, is like, I miss the days of being able to just embrace what was going to happen. All right, this next track is Wild Things. I won't try to make you different, because where you are is where I want to be. I'll go where the wild things are. Wait, are you going to hit, me back to back on these vocals? I can't get over it, dude. I really can't. I'm just so fucking stoked for him. Like, he just sounds incredible. Like, truly majestic in these last two tracks for sure. I love his vocals anyways, but I want to point out whenever I feel like it is even further than I would have expected his voice to be. And I know he's very talented, but these last two songs, I feel like they're just hitting a different chord. And I think that there seems to be something with the last track and even with this track where I feel like the lyrics do play a big part in where Ashton's voice is going to go. Because, you know, in Glory Days, it seemed like longing for those times of kind of like jumping in and just, you know, just letting life happen. In Wild Things, there's this love and there's this vulnerability of saying, like, I'm going to follow you. I will follow you into the dark, but I will also follow you into the light. The point is, I'm going to follow you wherever, because I love you and I'm here for you and I want to support you and I want to be there. And that vulnerability and softness comes out in his voice so much. And I think that right there creates that sound that I love so much from him. When all those complicated, messy thoughts cloud up your head, I know your thorns protect your roses. You let me in, the gates are open. Oh, yeah. That right there is my shit. I just feel like I can hear the song. It goes up. Then we take a journey in through this like thing, and then we end up on the other side. So sick. I'm obsessed. I'm fucking obsessed. Dude, that's it right there. Those last two songs are fucking awesome. So good. I love Wild Things so much on this first listen. I have goosebumps. I got the chills right now. My kneecap is so uncomfortable because it has the goosebumps right now. Because I just feel like Ashton... I have ADHD, okay? I feel like Ashton truly connected to the love that he feels to write this song. Like, and if you don't feel that way just based on the lyrics, it doesn't matter. Listen to him deliver this. You can't tell me he doesn't believe the words that he's singing in the song to whoever he wrote this about. I want to point out that that is one of my favorite fucking things to pick up on. My body has a reaction when I feel that, because you can fake a lot of shit. You can fake almost anything. But holy shit, dude, you cannot fake real passion and real like fucking emotion. And I think that when I hear it in song, and it's why I listen to so many artists that do like, you know, either like singer-songwriter type stuff or, you know, we'll dive into the lyrics of a lot of stuff. It's because the minute that I hear that connection, you could fucking tell me anything, I'm gonna know that you're telling me the truth. It's just the craziest shit. Ashton is so fucking real on this. So I love this song so much, and I just feel like more people have to hear this. I swear we better not sleep on this. I'm like late to this party, but like I did the first one the day it came out. I didn't know there was gonna be another part. Okay, this is the last song. This is Endless Wave. So smooth right there. I'm gonna be so real with you guys. Love the instrumental right here. I'm not a huge fan of the filter effect on Ashton's voice right here. I'm sure because the song's long, it'll build out. But right now, it's like at the beginning, I get it. I'm not a huge fan of it right now, though. This song just like picked up right there. Now, I do like that, though. I actually can't even tell if that was a synth that they just used or if that was his voice hitting, just holding that note and then they used that. Either way, that was fucking sick. Woo! I love that they like, you know what? Like when you have this big instrumental like this, there's a lot of space, right? Because like the tempo is not like super upbeat. So there's just like a lot of space. And I actually love that they've utilized some really cool percussion or just like just perks in general, not just on the song throughout the whole album, but specifically on the song, you hear it where you've got these big gaps of like, you know, you got some room to play with. And so you hear these like, you know, a whistle that'll go up or like something that just kind of adds more atmosphere to it and adds more texture to the song. And I love that. It is literally just to vibe out. Okay, so I realized by the end what was going on with that vocal that I didn't like. The only time I wasn't feeling it was whenever we would just get into a verse. And the reason being is once you strip the instrumental back that far, I guess like personally, I Ashton's got such a good voice. And I understand the point of like putting it in this kind of filter and giving it this vibe because the vocal's not the main point of the song, right? There's like, it is just as mixed as this whole fucking instrumental because it is, there's a lot, right? We got a lot of atmosphere. There's a lot to jam here. But I think because of all that extra space, I personally in the verse would have loved to hear maybe not as much effect on Ashton's vocal. But then in the verse or in the chorus, I'm sorry, absolutely. It sounds fucking sick, especially as like some of the like higher frequencies come in. I just feel like that sounded so fucking sick. I had no idea what was going on in the lyrics to this. It's a little bit harder to pay attention to, but I definitely feel like the song stands as that moment to just fucking jam. Like, let that moment happen. Let that emotion ride. Maybe I'm a little bit hard on the vocal mixing right now just because I came off of two of my favorite songs from Ashton Irwin ever and two of my favorite vocal moments from him ever. It's a little hard to go to a song that like isn't supposed to really be vocals. That's my problem, right? I'm so stoked about what Ashton has done with disc two of Blood on the Drums. I feel like this project feels whole now. It feels complete. Not that it didn't before, but I felt like an 8-song album wasn't going to be an album or an EP, and it turns out he had a plan all along, and I'm so glad he did. I think he explored a lot of great stuff here, not only just with, again, his vocals and that delivery and all that work that he's put in, but he's also diving into more of his vulnerability and showing even more of himself, wearing a little bit more of his heart on his sleeve. I feel like in the canyon where, you know, and I could be wrong about all these things but that I'm about to say, just I'm just saying what I'm feeling. I feel like in the canyon we're talking about just, you know, embracing life, remembering to live your life because this beauty is here, but it could, you know, be gone any moment. California holds her breath. I love this idea of while there could be a bigger metaphor here, I do like the idea of people still celebrating California as that place to follow your dreams. I feel like in California and New York have always been that. And I don't always hear people talking about that the same anymore. I feel like sometimes California and Los Angeles can get a pretty bad rep these days. But in all honesty, that is the place where dreams can come true for so many people. So I love that little spark. Come on, when you have that love in your life that truly like ignites you and makes you want to do better and be better, that's incredible. And he is so in touch with the fact that not only, well, I think he had it and maybe he was losing it, or maybe he just doesn't want to lose it, but being in touch with that's important. Wicked Habit, pop punk perfection right there. Marry You, that confidence and swagger all over the song. Glory Days and Wild Things, truly greatest songs on this. I don't even need to say anymore. Endless Wave, I fucking love that it is just this fucking jam out 70s kind of vibe right there in such a cool way. He did incredible with this, and I know y'all agree with me, so I hope that everybody is hyping this up as much as I am, because I think this is sick. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. You gotta let me know what your favorite songs are. You already know what mine are. I'm not gonna make you hear me talk about it again, but if you guys like this video, make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel. If you guys want to support my Patreon, I have a lot of 5 Seconds of Summer content. I have a lot of just like album reactions and all kinds of cool stuff, including this disc one and disc two as album reactions. And if you just want to support me, I love y'all. I don't sponsor my channel. I don't like sell y'all shit or anything. So if you want to check out Patreon, I appreciate you. I will see y'all in the next one. Peace.